A woman drank 4 liters of juice every day for 3 years. This is what happened to her organs. JL is a 45-year-old woman presenting to the emergency room with nausea and extreme abdominal pain. She tells the admitting physician that she lost at least 20 pounds over the last few weeks. Years ago, JL noticed that her eyes would hurt for no reason. Every time she tried to blink, it was pain. Her mouth was dry. She had never been this tired in her life, and she went to go get this checked out. In the hospital, the physical exam and blood test were clear. JL was dehydrated. Tears and saliva are made from water. The brain needs proper hydration to function adequately. If she doesn't have enough water, then she'll have problems with all of these things. So the doctor told her, "I think you need to drink a little more water, around 3 liters a day for women." She doesn't need to worry. This is an easy fix. No medicines needed, as she was discharged from the hospital with these directions. But when JL got home, she drank more water than she had ever had in her life, and it did nothing. JL had always enjoyed orange juice. Thinking that it would help, she tried to have a glass, and then her dry mouth was fixed. Even if it was just for a short time, it was better than water. A glass before bed would help her sleep a little bit better. But a glass here and there started becoming several liters every day, and the more she drank, the thirstier she got. JL thought her dry mouth was fixed, but when she didn't drink the juice, the dryness really never went away, and her eyes were still dry. She started feeling really tired all the time. It wasn't just fatigue, though. JL started noticing a gnawing sensation in her stomach. She would feel like she was in trouble, and that for some reason, something was happening that was all her fault. But nothing had changed. This anxiety started eating away at her, and she didn't know where it was coming from. One evening after dinner, JL's stomach started to hurt. It was a pain so intense like nothing she had ever felt before. She felt like she was going to have a panic attack as she goes to the emergency room where we are now. At examination, the medical team finds that JL is in pain and distress. Despite feeling thirsty, she wasn't able to keep anything down and she could only keel over in a world of hurt. A blood test finds that JL has hyperglycemia. Hyper meaning high, glycy from Greek referring to glucose or sugar, and emia meaning presence in blood. High sugar presence in blood. If JL had been consuming 4 liters of juice every day for a long time, and she has hyperglycemia, well, juice has a lot of sugar, so this should make sense. Except the medical team don't know that she's been drinking this juice. She didn't tell them. And when they looked closer, they also find that she has acidemia, acid presence in blood. But what does that mean? The body's cells are constantly functioning to maintain normal homeostasis. To function requires energy, and the process of making energy is called metabolism. A byproduct produced during metabolism is acid. If JL has hyperglycemia and sugar is used to produce energy, then we could say that something might have gone wrong with her metabolism, causing excess acid to spill into her blood. This could mean that her body, for some reason, is making more acid than normal, but why is it doing that? The opposite of acid is base. The body balances both. If acid is high, then base is low. But did JL's body suddenly make a lot of acid, or did it suddenly lose a lot of base? Well, the kidneys maintain acid-base balance through the urine. The blood test reveals that JL's kidneys are shutting down, so they might be unable to eliminate acid, causing an accumulation, or they might be getting rid of too much base. When the medical team tests JL's urine, they find a massive presence of a chemical called a ketone, and this gives them more clues as to what's happening. When you eat, food quickly breaks down into sugar, proteins, and fats, and absorbs from the small intestines into the liver and then into the bloodstream. It's here, after the meal, where the pancreas releases the hormone insulin to shove sugar from the blood into the body's cells to be used for energy. The problem is, during times of extreme stress, the body releases a different set of hormones. Insulin is a rest and digest hormone, but extreme stress is a time of fight or flight, and that takes precedence because it's often an immediately life-threatening stimulus triggering it. The liver is forced to release stores of sugar, causing blood sugar to increase. Fats are liberated as an additional energy source for the body, but in this setting, the body's too rushed, and these fats aren't broken down correctly. They become keto acids. These cause not only intense abdominal pain, but also dehydration, explaining most of what's happening to JL, but something's wrong. This doesn't happen to healthy people. When this happens to a patient, their body has had an underlying problem with insulin for some time. This means that she could have diabetes, but JL had no record of diabetes. No one knew about her 4 liters of juice daily. She didn't tell them. What doctors did find was that JL had pancreatitis. Itis meaning an inflammation, and pancreas being the organ that produces and releases insulin along with digestive hormones and enzymes. Do you remember extreme stress? Well, pancreatitis is the immune system responding to the pancreas. Something, or the immune system itself, caused the pancreas to digest itself, and in the ensuing chaos, the body damaging itself is a stressful event. In response, JL's body released hormones to deal with this stress, forcing cells to use alternative energy sources instead of sugar, despite there being so much sugar in the blood, causing keto acids to spill into the blood, causing worsening hyperglycemia, acidosis, abdominal pain, dehydration, and kidney failure, explaining everything happening to JL. If her problem is dehydration, give her fluids. And if her body can't produce or release enough insulin relative to what her cells can respond to, then give her insulin. As the days pass with this treatment, JL seemed to get a little bit better. She was mostly on IV fluids, so her mouth was so terribly dry. But when she was well enough to go home, things seemed like they were getting better, and she was doing okay, but only for a short time. One morning, JL was brushing her teeth. She noticed that her gums really hurt. There was bleeding all over the toothpaste. She wasn't eating much, but she kept drinking her juice every day. Everything in her body started to hurt, and it wasn't just her muscles. It felt like pain was going all the way down into her bones. At the dentist, JL had multiple cavities. She would drink her juice after brushing her teeth at night, and then go to bed. Because she didn't even rinse, the sugar stayed in pockets inside her mouth. Bacteria ate that sugar and started producing acid that decayed her teeth, producing cavities. Some of the decay was so advanced, those teeth needed to be extracted. When the dentist looked inside her mouth, they noticed that it was unusually dry. After her teeth were pulled, she was given antibiotics and sent home, but she had trouble swallowing the pills, so she didn't even bother. Nothing was taken. As the days passed, JL started getting chills. She was having trouble breathing. She felt like her heart was skipping beats and her entire body hurt. On the couch, napping, JL was dreaming, but then she fell off. Immediately, pain seared through her body. It felt like a knife had plunged into her hip. As the pain got worse and worse, she called for an ambulance and is brought to the emergency room again. Portioning what you eat and drink helps curb excess, and one thing that can help you with that is ordering from this video's sponsor, Factor. Factor delivers fresh, never frozen, dietitian-approved meals right to your doorstep. They offer delicious, flavor-packed options on the menu every week to fit a variety of lifestyles, from keto to calorie smart, vegan and veggie, and protein plus. If you're looking to mix things up, you can add a protein to select vegan and veggie meals every week. I've been a subscriber for more than a year now, and I also buy it for my parents. It's a huge time saver for all of us. It's not just saving time against meal prep, but the actual time to eat a meal is so much shorter. That's great for when you're busy at work or even busy with life. And the food is delicious. Factor offered to sponsor this video. Head to factor75.com or click the link in the description below and use code EMU50 to get 50% off your first Factor box and 20% off your next month of orders. That's code EMU50 at factor75.com to get 50% off your first box plus 20% off your next month of orders. I highly recommend it. At examination, again, the medical team looks at the scan of the hip and it appears that JL has a broken hip. This isn't uncommon as someone ages into elderhood, but JL is only 45. She's not elderly. A fall off a couch, which isn't that high, at her age, shouldn't break a bone. The medical team becomes increasingly concerned. Things that can cause bone pain and sudden, unexpected weight loss ending with a major fracture from a minor fall at this age are chronic infection, autoimmune disease, or cancer. A blood test finds that she has a huge number of white blood cells floating around, much more than normal. Given that JL had also had a fever, all of this could mean that she has some kind of infection, but something's wrong. When they listened to her heartbeat, they heard extra sounds that weren't there before, meaning that something is happening to the blood as it's flowing through. Doctors noticed that JL had a swelling on her left side that was causing her an extreme amount of pain. When they sent sound waves into her chest to take a look at her heart, they find a vegetation growing all over the area where the heart connects to the aorta, the largest artery in the body that carries oxygenated blood everywhere in the body. This vegetation is a fibrous mass of protein and bacteria that's leaking its contents into her bloodstream, meaning that JL has a bacterial infection growing in her heart. This infective endocarditis was likely from her not taking the antibiotics after getting her teeth pulled, and the bacteria migrated from her mouth into her bloodstream before settling into a valve in her heart. But this infection by itself shouldn't cause her bones to break from a minor fall at her age, so something more is going on, but what could it be? Doctors took a closer look at the scan of her hip. It wasn't a complete fracture. When they looked at her chest to see her heart, they noticed that it looked like there were cracks in her ribs. They weren't complete fractures, but rather, it looked like her bones were weak, like her bone mineral density was reduced. And given that she has additional abnormalities in her blood related to this, JL has osteomalacia. Osteo meaning bone, malacia pronounced malachia in some languages because it's from Greek malakos meaning soft. Her bones were soft, but what does that mean? Bones are made from calcium and phosphate. At any given time, a portion of all bone surface in a body is undergoing the process of forming new bone. But when calcium or phosphate or both become low in the body, bone becomes weak. But why would they become low? Sometimes hypophosphatemia, low phosphate presence in blood, happens in times of vitamin D deficiency. This might be happening to JL, but the kidneys can accidentally eliminate too much phosphate when there's excess sugar floating around in the blood, so much so that it comes out in the urine, both of which were happening to her. Sometimes in chronic metabolic acidosis like JL had when she presented to the emergency room the last time can also force the kidneys to eliminate calcium, and the acidemia also wastes the bones away. Because her hip fracture wasn't complete, she didn't need surgery for her bone, but she did need surgery to repair the heart valve that was growing the infective vegetation. JL was started on antibiotics to destroy the bacteria before surgeons operate. They were able to successfully do the repair, and she seemed to recover well. But fixing her heart isn't going to fix her bones. It isn't going to prevent her from actually fracturing something next time, and it isn't going to fix her kidneys or what happens to be her diabetes problem. In the recovery room, JL's husband brought her the juice. When the doctor came in to talk to her, he noticed the excess bottles. Confused, he asked her what this was, and it was here, where she told him about the 4 liters of juice that she drank every day. It was because her mouth was constantly dry and water just didn't help. The juice helped for a while, but it never really got the feeling of sand out of her eyes, and it's here where the medical team got the final clue as to what was happening to JL. Do you remember the possibility of chronic infection, autoimmune disease, or cancer? Well, endocarditis wasn't a chronic infection. JL was tested for HIV and hepatitis C, chronic infections that can cause bone pain and sudden unplanned weight loss, but she didn't have any of those. She also didn't have cancer, but two of the doctors remembered when JL had come in with pancreatitis, and they never figured out exactly why. But how is this related to the 4 liters of juice? Pancreatitis is the immune system acting on the pancreas. In JL's case, the immune system may have initiated the damage, meaning it was autoimmune. If the medical team never fully ruled out autoimmune disease, and JL had been complaining about extreme dry mouth and dry eyes, even coming to the hospital multiple times because of those, then autoimmune disease might be why her mouth is dry. Looking closer in her blood, they found huge amounts of antibodies floating around, indicating that the immune system in JL's body was extremely active. This could be because she just had a life-threatening infection, but there was more. If her mouth was dry, it means that she isn't making saliva. The medical team took a sample of her salivary gland to look at underneath a microscope. They found white blood cells everywhere in the tissue, confirming that JL's immune system had been attacking her salivary glands, disabling them, stopping saliva production, and forcing her mouth to become dry. Because she isn't making tears anymore either, it means that the immune system has attacked her lacrimal glands too, causing her dry eyes. Putting all of this together, JL has primary Sjogren's disease, an autoimmune disease where the immune system attacks the salivary and lacrimal glands. At the moment, we don't know exactly what causes the immune system to target these specifically. It appears more often in women versus men, and it usually appears in mid-age. It could be due to environmental or genetic factors, but like many other autoimmune problems, we don't know for sure. What we do know is that the dry mouth prompted her juice consumption in search of relief, but in reality became an excessive 4 liters daily. The massive sugar load for so long caused metabolic derangements in her body, and adding sugar to a dry mouth rapidly decays the teeth, causing cavities at a minimum, and the ensuing poor oral hygiene can cause terrible infections in the body. An overactive immune system might have caused her pancreatitis the first time. Her kidneys had gotten damaged by the constant inflammation and started having trouble maintaining acid-base balance, leading to a chronic metabolic acidosis and to her bones demineralizing and weakening in her body. And without addressing the underlying inflammation early, her poor oral hygiene and tooth decay resulted in endocarditis. But it was a suspected broken hip that gave everyone a more clear idea of what was happening to JL. These aren't the only things that can happen in Sjogren's disease, but they are what happened to her. As the medical team were able to get clarity on JL's condition, they were able to plan her treatment with her. Medicines can limit inflammation, but some of them, like corticosteroids, can come at the cost of debilitating side effects. Steroids can worsen her bone weakness, her hyperglycemia, and her neuropsychiatric symptoms. She was started on a different disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drug and given instructions for follow-up. This should help limit immune system activity and alleviate her symptoms, but more specifically, for her dry eyes, she was given artificial tears. These are eye drops to be applied regularly, and she was taught how to better manage her dry mouth without sugary or acidic drinks. A hard limit on colas, tea, coffee, juices, and energy drinks was directed. Small sips of water regularly with oral moisturizing gel. Swish and spit multiple times daily to relieve. Because limited saliva production can cause difficulty in maintaining good oral hygiene, she was also taught how best to brush her teeth. It's not very common that people have Sjogren's disease. Even if you don't have an autoimmune disease, the sugar from drinking 4 liters of juice every day is going to cause problems, not only inside your body from all that excess carbohydrate, but also can and will cause problems with your teeth. After getting the medical care that she needed and being diligent with maintaining the treatment of her eyes, oral hygiene, and body, JL was able to make a recovery. Thanks so much for watching. Take care of yourself and be well.